Welcome back to the Rope Access channel. This is going to be a very exciting video. As you can see, I'm at the Petzl village in front of their beautiful training center. And in this video, I will take you on a tour through the factory, testing institute, training institute. And we're going to talk to one of their product managers, Benjamin of Petzl on the Pro line. So let's get into this. Woo! This is actually a two-part video. And this is part one that you are watching. And this is only the highlights. So Benjamin is going to answer a few of my questions and give some insights to all the procedures and the way Petzl operates and the philosophies in their company. It was a really interesting interview, but it was just too long. So it's over an hour and I'm releasing the first video as a sort of highlight, a few of the questions. And if you want to know more, then you can watch the full video that will be released later on. It's going to be unedited at all. You get all the information, all the deep dives into the Petzl Astro, the Petzl Astro Sit, the Avao, all the harnesses, all the good stuff. Every question is answered. So enjoy this video and stay tuned for the full length version that's coming later on. Have fun. Like I said, I'm here with Benjamin from Petzl, and you are one of the product managers, or the product manager of a few of the products of Petzl. Yep. So can you explain a little bit about that, who you are, what your job
absolutely.
Is?
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. So I'm Benjamin Langron, one of the product manager for Petzl, in charge of the specialized market. It means the rope market, rope access, rescue, tree care, tactical. That kind of product. I've been working for 7 years now as this position for Petzl. So I'm in charge of the full market from helmet to pantine, for instance, the foot ascender. And the main products are harnesses, definitely Astro, the rig, the IDs, ASAP lock, for instance, for rope access technicians, such kind of product, and all ropes, rope ascenders, etc.
All right.
So quite
a lot of products.
Very interesting, versatile.
Cool. So yeah, I have a full list here of questions, and sent some of them in. So I can't remember them all. So I have my little cheat sheet here. You already covered a few. With the international and the European version, what are some of the differences between it?
Main differences are related to the requirements of NC and CSA standards. So for instance, a minimum width of webbing, like 44 millimeters.
Ah, okay.
So that's why in European version, where we can, we optimize to 28 millimeters the webbing. So it's lighter. Thinner, obviously, and it reduces as well the size of the buckles, which is not possible on some of the webbing and buckles on the international version.
Right.
So that's, I would say, the main differences is the material, steel versus aluminium. So steel for international and aluminium for European version, and the size, the width of webbing and buckle. We simply have to adjust it. The construction here between the European and the international is slightly different. We have the sliding webbing, but due to the NC standard, we need to put an extra plastic ring because the NC standard or the NFPA, it doesn't matter, require that the webbing should not be in direct contact with the metallic part.
Oh,
so that's why on international version, you will have this plastic ring to be between the webbing and the D-ring, for instance.
Yeah, one of the questions that I got was like, why is it, there are multiple linked into the same thing. Why is it not on all the harnesses is one.
Yeah.
And the other one is, why is this called the Astro?
Yeah,
because this is a very sturdy fixed point harness, and this is a lot more movable and flexible. Yeah. But it gives a little bit—that's my—that's what I think—a little bit of less rest when you're suspended all the time. So why? Yeah.
Yeah. What we saw with the first generation of Astro, full body harness is more popular. It's more demanded by end users. So that's why we choose to be more conservative on the two version of full body harness, and vice versa on the Astro Sit in combination with top crawl, we would to introduce a different construction to offer an alternative to some end users, especially advanced to expert. Experienced end users. Some of them will probably stick to the more traditional approach and construction, and vice versa. Hopefully, at least they try. If they like it, perfect.
Yeah,
that's good. If they prefer to stay to remain on the full body harness, so that's why we took the I would say the opportunity to use the Astro seat as a try, let's say, right, in this way, to offer a different approach with, I would say, this sport construction with the textile bridges and with some ease of movement, yeah, and so on. And probably in the upcoming years, we will see if it's a good call or not. Yeah. Sometimes we do, yeah, we have pretty good feedback. Frankly speaking, the feedback I have since we launched the first prototype and samples and so on are quite positive. But like you mentioned, it doesn't fit 100% of end users. No. That's why it was a little bit risky for us to implement this construction on a full body harness. So yeah, for now, yeah, full body harness is the majority of sales because of the sternal or dorsal, yeah, attachment point and so on. But for some end users, market specific use, we do believe it could be an alternative.
Yeah.
Maybe sliding, I talk about sliding webbing and so on. That's the principle of a webbing that gets loose or not. What we implemented in any double back buckle, but even on openable buckle, we have now I would say this small accessory that comes on any buckles and to avoid that the webbing get loose.
Yeah.
So it's valid on the leg loops, for instance. So here we have this cover. So as soon as you put the right adjustment, if you do the things properly, you are supposed to put the webbing like this, and then you cannot get loose.
Yeah.
Not anymore, I would say. We know that it could be a little bit annoying, I would say, to always readjust and so on. So that's why in any buckles now, openable or double back, thin, large, whatever, we offer this accessory. It's already mounted, and the end users has nothing to do. So the purpose of that is to limitate as much as possible that the webbing get loose hours after hours and so on. Product development at Petzl is mainly based on end users' feedback.
Yeah, okay.
So
yeah,
we exactly try to put end users, it could be a caver, it could be a mountaineer, it could be a rope access technician. We try to focus first on the daily basis and what he would like to have in the perfect world.
Yeah.
So we based product development on this. It's a balance between existing product and new product, how complex is, how many resources we're gonna need to bring or to develop this product, for instance, especially if we start from scratch, like a new product category we don't address.
Yeah.
It's maybe not 3, but 4 or even 5 years of development, because like I say, the research phase will last a year, 18 months maybe. And sometimes, unfortunately for us, after a year of 18 months, we say, stop. We will not make it simply, or it will cost too much, and we will not get a feedback, a payback on the investment and so on. So, it's a complex
Is this something question. I heard yesterday from Reinhard, who's behind the camera? It's like you only put out a new product if it actually improves on something, not just to be, I can't think of an example, but for instance, I don't know, let's say the Petzl didn't make headlamps, for instance. Yeah. And let's make a headlamp because the others do it, and you just put out sort of the same. Now, actually, the philosophy is like we want to make something that's actually better or improves.
Yeah, we consider ourselves as a premium brand. We know that innovation and being part of the top of the manufacturers is in our history, and we focus on this part. I mean, just make sure that we continue to be in the most innovation brand possible and so on.
Because the standard is 15 kilonewtons, right,
on
for this?
Yeah. Any single 358, 361, it's a minimum of 15 kilonewtons. But usually when we test it, you test it as a full arrest system or suspension system and so on. For lateral gearing, even if you are supposed to use them
doubled,
in the same time, the standards require individual testing. So you have like a fall on one single point, and it's a minimum of 15 kilonewton
as well. Yeah.
Strengths and so on.
Maybe I have one question for you.
Oh, for me?
You have, I would say, the chance or the opportunity to use the product in different environments, from a training center to offshore platform or whatever. What are your thoughts in terms of product choice? Why you pick this product instead of this one? What are the reasons you pick this product?
So if I'm being split right now between Alex the nerd climber and the rope access professional sort of. But if you keep it on the working practical side, for me it's like I want the safest backup device. Mm-hmm. And if I'm talking about getting probably like, again, like 80% of people get them on an ID, because if it's, for me, it's like the safest descender, especially with if you thread a rope in the wrong way. So those are the two major ones. And that the whole team, everybody has the same kit.
Yep.
So that everybody, if we're working together, all of us, and we have the same gear and something happens, or I don't know, I leave my ID on the ground, climb up 20 meters and I need to go down, I can just get your backup device or your backup descender sort of thing and use it the same way. And of course, a rig or an ID or like, it's a thing with a pull the handle and go down, they're almost all the same sort of, but still having everything the same keeps it safer, in my opinion.
Okay.
Yeah. But for me as the nerd climber, I picked a device that suits the job I'm going to do. And I'm lucky enough that I have a ton of different gear. Yep. And then sometimes it's not a Petzl device, but another device. Yeah. But still, especially when teaching, keep it simple, keep it the same. And
Okay. Yeah.